not that long ago, a few months ago, I had a guest in, and he was a head teacher. His name was Jason O'Rourke, and he was from the Washingborough Academy. And he sort of popped up to my, got my attention because of the way that the Washingborough Academy is dealing with the whole process of food within the school. It's an integral part of the school. They use food, cooking, gardening, growing, eating, everything within all aspects of their school and their education programme, which was, it encourages the children to think more about what they eat. So by the time they're adults, they're making some decisions which we maybe would like them to make. It's really, really interesting. Now, Jason got in contact with me recently to let me know that Professor Einar Resvik was coming to Washingborough. Now, he's a scientist at the Norwegian Food Research Institute, and I really, really wanted to meet him to learn more about why he was coming. I mean, he's coming from Norway, and he's coming to our corner of Lincolnshire. He's coming to Washingborough to take back what we're doing, and I think that's really, really fantastic. So I popped along to meet him yesterday morning, and I was interested to learn Einar's role back in Norway and what brought him that day to the Washingborough Academy.
We are here, a group of eight Norwegians representing different things. It's myself, I'm a scientist, but I'm also working with a chef in a tasting school, and we bring with us a Norwegian municipality who want to transform the schools and kindergartens to something better. And for us, Washingborough Academy is actually the ideal. That's where we want to go.
And what's your role within the Institute back in Norway? What's your role?
I'm a scientist working on innovation in the public sector, actually, trying to transform the public sector to address problems in a new and different way. And for me, this is all about innovation.
What can you tell us about the area in Norway that you're from?
This area is quite similar to this, I think. It's an hour's drive from north of Oslo. It's an area with huge agricultural production, but most of this goes into the commercial chains. So very little actually stays behind in the community, which is something we want also to change, that the community use local resources more.
Is this your first trip to Lincolnshire?
First trip to Lincolnshire, but I know the principal here from before because we work together in a European organization called SAPERE, which has the ambition to actually work on food and tasting schools throughout Europe.
And when you arrived here in Lincolnshire, could you see similarities in terms of the agriculture and the farmland surrounding in comparison to your own municipality?
It's very much the same. I mean, we're within community distance to Oslo, and the production is huge. I mean, they could feed all of Norway from this municipality. So the focus is not on grain so much. The focus is on vegetables and fruit, which is something we want more of in the diet of children.
So what is typically growing around you at home in Norway?
This community has probably the whole production of onions in Norway, and they have cabbage, a lot of cabbages, different types, Brussels sprouts, a lot of salads. They have apples and lots of berries, like strawberries and raspberries.
It doesn't sound too dissimilar to Lincolnshire.
No, it's actually quite similar, more than I thought when I came here.
Is the climate similar?
That too. I mean, today it's actually as warm as here. It's the same. But I think in the wintertime we have more snow.
I asked Einar to explain the culture of food in schools in Norway because I wanted to learn more about how different it was there to here, because we can learn a lot about ourselves from other cultures, I think. So I asked him about the culture of food in schools in Norway.
We are one of three countries in Europe where school food is not compulsory. So we actually rely very much on children bringing packages of food for lunch from home. And as you know, with the changing Europe, this is a dying habit. 25% of all people in Oslo, for instance, are immigrants. And they don't have any tradition for bringing school food to schools. So this is a very difficult situation in the country where social differences are increasing because of the different habits of the different parts of the population.
So is the expectation for people who are making Norway their home that they go to school and their child is fed?
Of course. I mean, if you move to any country in Europe, that would be the expectation. So it's a very difficult situation, I think, for Norway. And many municipalities see that it's their role actually to make the change and the transfer. And then it depends on the economy and the municipality, and that's very different. Parents struggle a lot because many people, I mean, even immigrants from countries like Sweden, have never brought food to school. So they don't know what to bring, and they bring all sorts of things and all odd things. So, I mean, we see a huge variety, and of course you see the gap, in the social gap increasing, because the people don't know how to do this and have no tradition for doing it. They bring the wrong things. And then if you're born in the country, you bring the right things sometimes, because you used it, you grow up with it. But we see the social gaps increasing, and then the social differences, because food is a huge impact on your performance in school.
You've got some interesting figures to support that, haven't you?
Yes, we've seen one school in the less fortunate areas outside of Oslo. It's probably one of the worst areas, where they had police in the school every day. This is a school going from 7th grade to 10th grade, so it's actually youth from 11 to 15. They were smoking, they were using drugs in school, they were bullying in school. Extremely high report, self-reported bullying. And then the headmaster said, we can't have it like this, we have to change. So she introduced a cafeteria and school food and proper food. And since then, they've actually seen in the transformation in 5-6 years, bullying is reduced by 75%. Obesity is going down. Marks in concentration topics like math has gone up by 50%. And this is on the international comparable tests that you're doing across Europe. So, I mean, it's remarkable, because they've gone from being at the lowest low in Europe to the highest high.
What kind of food was served?
When she brought the food in, she brought in a chef. And then she didn't allow the chef to do anything the chef wanted. So the chef were told that you have to use the... I mean, there's recommendations for what you're supposed to serve when it comes to amount of protein, how much fat... So they're introduced fish on the menu twice a week. They have increased the amount of vegetables, coarse grains, and reduced the amount of free sugars, fast carbohydrates, and the wrong fats. Because concentration lasts the whole day. So I usually say that a meal is supposed to bring you, keep your concentration up all the way to the next meal.
This drive to make the school dinners available in Norway, is it a large drive? Is it something that everyone's behind? Are you close to making it happen?
We hope so. Politically, it's difficult, because if you want to introduce it, you have to go through government and then you have to get a budget. And of course, in Europe today, getting a budget for a large sum of money like that is difficult. So we've actually worked with different models for financing it, where you do a combination of support from the government, support from the local municipality, from parents, and from NGOs or local organizations, like the Women's Farmers Union is actually helping out quite a lot in schools to make this happen, to reduce the price for the less fortunate.
Now that is Professor Einar Resvik. He's a scientist at the Norwegian Food Research Institute, and he's been in Lincolnshire this week at the Washingborough Academy to learn how we do things in Lincolnshire, and to learn from a really, really good example such as Washingborough Academy how they do things, so he can go back to Norway and find out more. We'll be going back to him in a little while, and also going back to the kitchen for more. So, having a chat with Professor Einar Resvik, who I met yesterday. He's the scientist at the Norwegian Food Research Institute that come to Lincolnshire to learn more about the work of Washingborough Academy. As somebody who's passionate about food and feels very strongly about the way we interact with food in our own lives, the effect it has on our lives and our future, I'm really proud of Washingborough Academy and its head teacher, Jason O'Rourke. The things he's doing there are revolutionary. He's being watched by the government. The government got keeping their eye on him and using him as a case study. And I'm really, really proud of what they're doing. So back to my chat with Einar. And I wondered how long him and his 8 colleagues were staying at the in Lincolnshire at the Washingborough Academy, and what they hoped to gain from the visit.
We're actually coming for a visit here at the school today, and that's it. But I know Jason, so I'll see him again later on, so I'll pick up the threads if there's any loose ends. But what we hope to get from here is inspiration for the municipality that we bring along, so that they can go back and say, we have to do this, we have to make changes. And then we are looking for financial support for similar programs in Norway, where school food is being introduced in a more holistic way. So it's not only introducing a meal, it's actually introducing the culture around the food, where the food comes from, what food does to you, that food can actually be a tool and a topic for other learning situations, like in math or in foreign languages, in about culture, following the food all the way from the seed they hold in their hand until they put it in their mouth as a finished vegetable. That's extremely important for kids to understand the whole process.
So you'll be taking back the, sort of the findings and the observations and recommendations from your visit to Lincolnshire back to Norway. Are you going to be putting your report on some important desks?
Oh yes, of course. I've just been elected chair of the Norwegian School Food, or Friends for School Food, which is an NGO working for introducing school food in Norway. And we have, actually on Monday when I come home, I will have a meeting with the Department of Health, and later on in the summer we'll have a meeting with the bigger political parties in Norway in the parliament, where we'll take all this inspiration, all the learnings from here, and bring it on to political Norway.
What things in particular have you noticed about Washingborough Academy and the maybe going from the atmosphere, the behaviour of the children, and the whole integration of food?
I mean, just walking in the door here, you understand that this is a different school. You feel it all immediately when you walk in. And I think the holistic idea that they're actually they're not just eating food, but they're following the food through the whole value chain is extremely important for children to learn. It's a learning situation worth, you can't measure in money, I think.
I'm just chuckling at all the little shushes because they're louder than the shushes are louder than the chattering. But it's lovely. There is a nice atmosphere here and the children do look really happy.
A lot of children today actually grow up in families where the parents are the limitations to what they want to eat. And if the parents have actually reduced their choices dramatically, then that's also going to happen to the children. But in the school, you're exposed to new people, new situation, to people coming from different backgrounds. So you actually open up, and that will last for the whole life.
If you could fast forward yourself to, say, 50 years' time, or even sort of 75 years' time, what would you hope that the food relationship in schools with the children is like across in Norway and across the planet?
If you look at the World Health Organization, they've actually estimated that between 50 and 60% of all disease, not only obesity, but all disease that we have, is actually related to food. And the Norwegian Department of Health has estimated that about 40% of this can actually be reduced by proper use of food. And if you don't introduce this in kindergarten and in school, you don't have a chance. So, I mean, the potential for the health budgets is tremendous, enormous. And if politicians don't see this, they're in deep trouble. And I think the only way forward is actually for the planet is that we are able to see that the health budget needs to be reduced through a better health, not by people paying more, because that's not the way. We have to reduce our disease frequency and the amounts of diseases. I mean, if you look at the diseases, obesity is obvious, but everything that has to do with inflammations is related to food. And this is probably the biggest box of disease, and it's growing tremendously all over the world, not only in the Western world, but also in poor countries. So, I mean, for the planet, it's imperative this happens.
Such an interesting man, and clearly very, very knowledgeable on our relationship with food across the globe, through all the various continents and countries. Such a very interesting man. That's Professor Einar Resvik, who was in Washingborough yesterday. And did you hear what he said? He's taking examples of what we're doing here in Lincolnshire. He's taking it back to the Department of Health in Norway, and he's going to also share it with the main Norwegian political parties. He's going back and he's saying this is what they're doing in England, in Lincolnshire, in Washingborough. I think that's just brilliant. I never sit here. Every week on Lincolnshire Kitchen, somebody amazes me with something they're doing in the food community in the county. It's just incredible. And I'm really, really proud of what Jason O'Rourke, the head teacher, is doing there. We've had a message in from Nina, who's in Washingborough. last trip back to Norway, to Einar, and I asked him what his itinerary was. And you know me, I'm very nosy. I had to know what he'd been eating, what he was having for his lunch, and what he had for his dinner the night before.
And most important thing is actually to see what they're doing and to get the feel for the atmosphere in the school. And as I said, it's as when you walk in the door, you get it, an immediate impression. But also it's important for us to understand how they actually integrate school gardens with the making of food and how they integrate this in the curriculum for the children. So that you get a holistic idea where school food and the making of food in schools actually contribute and is not a detachment or something that detached from learning. It's actually adding to learning and make learning happen in a better way, in a more organic way. And it can actually contribute to all levels. I mean, there's no prerequisite for learning when it comes to food. You don't have to be good in math to learn when you cook. It can happen to anyone, even with people with social and physical disabilities can actually be integrated in the same way and on equal terms to all others. So it's a very social tool.
What are you hoping is on the menu today at lunchtime?
I have no idea. I hope it's a fair proportion of vegetables, because vegetables traditionally is being under-prioritized by a lot of schools, because they seem to believe that children don't like them, and I think that's wrong. Hopefully we get some local foods. We had a wonderful tasting menu, and that was a local chef putting up a 7-course menu for us with only local ingredients. That was at the Browns restaurant and Lincolnshire tasting menu. And I've actually been working with local foods in the Nordic countries for 10 years. So to me, it was wonderful actually to try the local foods here. And I think we underestimate the value of this. And I think cultural pride in a region should be in the local produce. It's very important for a region to generate pride. And especially here, when you have so much to choose from.
I love what he said about a region generating pride. That is Lincolnshire, isn't it?